equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, follow us on Facebook, check out our YouTube channel, listen to our podcasts, and keep up to date with all of our projects at ruthinstitute.org. Father Paul Sullins is a guest of Father Robert McTeague on the Station of the Crosses, The Catholic Current. The question under discussion today is, born this way, does God make people gay?
Well, friends, you know, we always run a family-friendly show here in The Catholic Current. We're dealing with a mature topic today. Listener discretion is advised. If you've got young ears, you might want to consider waiting for the podcast after the broadcast today. We need to raise the question, born that way, did God make people gay? That seems to be a very common claim. Science might have a different response. Our expert guest is a research professor of sociology at the Catholic University of America and senior research associate of the Root Institute. Father Paul Sullins, welcome to the Catholic Current.
So happy to be with you today.
All right. Father, you published an article not long ago in Public Discourse, which is the Journal of the Witherspoon Institute, and you looked at some significant studies addressing the question as to whether or not people are born gay. I know over the years in my work in medical ethics, there's been people looking for the gay gene, for example. And if people are constituted that way genetically, then there is no choice about it. It is definitive, and then it's inevitable that you act on. And then there are people who take the claim of born that way and then spiritualize it, that if you were born gay, then God made you that way, and it would be ever so ungracious of you to reject that special gift of being born gay. So please act accordingly. I have my own take on that as a philosopher, as a theologian, as a metaphysician. You've been crunching the numbers. You've been looking at empirical science. What are the latest studies telling us?
Well, you know, it's a pervasive belief in our popular culture today that people who are with same-sex attraction or identify themselves as gay were born that way, and also that they cannot change that.
Right.
We saw that in the decision for gay marriage. One of the premises of the Obergefell decision was that the immutable nature of gay persons required that they have access to marriage to another person of the same sex in order to have the same kind of fulfillment as persons who can marry. People say heterosexually. I don't like necessarily that term, but I would say marry someone of the opposite sex.
Right, right.
So it's a really important issue today. And since the early 1990s, as our knowledge of the human genome began to increase, there has been a frenetic search to find the gay gene. You may remember it was on the cover of Time magazine, and Dean Hamer, a genetics researcher, rocketed to fame claiming that he had found the gay gene, but he had found nothing even close to that. But they latched onto that, and every two or three years, it seems like, they latch onto another exciting moment when someone has found finally the gay gene. But what happened last August was a study that not only did not find a gay gene, but that ruled out ever the possibility of finding a gay gene. It was a landmark change.
Father, can I interject just for a moment?
Yeah.
Because I know what you're saying is important. For the sake of argument, suppose there were a gay gene. Here's my take on it. Well,
right.
If I had a genetic predisposition to alcoholism, that doesn't make alcohol good for me, does it?
No, it doesn't.
No, okay. So, if one had a gay gene, that doesn't mean that acting on same-sex impulses is, say, good for the human body, does it?
Not from a faith perspective.
Right, or even from a biological perspective.
Because from a secular perspective, even an Aristotelian perspective, you say, I'm fulfilling my nature. I'm living out... Kind of the what is it? I forget the different causes, but
it's a final cause. But I would say that talking to my friends who teach biology, that even if there were a gay gene, the human body is not designed for sodomy. It's bad for the human body to do that. So that was my point, that even if there were a gay gene, it wouldn't do for people what they thought it would do for people. But now a study has come up that, if I understand you correctly, precludes the possibility of there being a gay gene. Tell us about that, please.
Yeah, sure. What we have known all along is that the evidence for the genetic influence on sexual orientation is fairly weak.
Mm-hmm.
So a gay gene implies that you have a very strong genetic determinism. That someone who is gay, they discover themselves to be gay, that they were innately determined to be that, and they're living out the way they were made. Well, there has never been that strong of a genetic influence on sexual orientation. The heritability of sexual orientation from twin studies was determined in 2015 to be 32%. So that's about a third of the variation in non-heterosexual sexual orientation is due to some genetic influence. It means that two-thirds is due to environment. The conclusion at that time was that you had twice as much environmental influence on someone having same-sex attraction as there was I'm getting lost in my sentence here. There's twice as much environmental influence as there is genetic influence on having same-sex attraction. Since that conclusion, we have a new way of looking at the human genome, and that is that we have sequenced the genome. And so instead of looking at twins and comparing the different sexual orientations of identical versus fraternal twins, we look at the genomes of lots of people. And from those people, we know which ones have identified themselves to be gay or have reported same-sex attraction. And we can see if those genomes are different than anyone else's. So in August, Nature Journal published a study that looked at almost 500,000 persons and compared their genetic structure with their sexual orientation. And what that study concluded, remarkably, was that the genetic influence on same-sex attraction was, you ready for this, 32%. It was the exact same finding that had been found in the twin studies. So here we have two streams of research using very different methodologies, and they converge on this very precise conclusion. Now, what does it mean when we say that it's 32% or 33% heritability?
That was my next question, yes.
Go ahead and ask it.
No, I can imagine someone just tuning in and say, well, gosh, one-third, that seems like a lot. But at the beginning of the segment, Father Sullen said it's zero. What's going on here?
Right. Well, I didn't say it's zero. I said it's very low.
Okay,
And it's not determined, right? So in almost all human traits, there is some genetic influence, right?
Okay.
We live our lives as a dynamic interaction of our genetic makeup and of our environment. And so in almost every trait, there is some genetic influence. So a genetic influence of 32% is a very small genetic influence. It is in the range of social values, of complex human traits. And it tells us that, of course, there is some genetic influence, but not that much. You mentioned earlier, for instance, alcoholism. Mm-hmm. The genetic heritability of alcoholism is about 60%. Well, that's pretty strong. But 32% is pretty small. Now, Diamond and Roski, two pro-LGBT scholars who have written about this, have pointed out that the estimates of heritability for same-sex attraction are lower than, and they use these following examples, having low back pain, smoking, feeling body dissatisfaction, and being divorced. Well, all of those things I've just mentioned are not things that anyone considers to be immutable or unchangeable. In fact,
right.
they reflect a lot of life choices and decisions and things that happen in our environment. So same-sex attraction is somewhere in that range of determinism. So, you know, we have to say that there are some people who are more likely or more prone to adopt a same-sex lifestyle or to report that they have same-sex attraction than other people, but it's not a very strong attraction. So people who say, well, it's completely a choice, well, that's not quite the case. But people who say it's completely determined, that's emphatically not the case.
Father, I want to read to you a line from your article recently published in Public Discourse, which is the journal of the Witherspoon Institute. I don't think it's too dense. There's some technical terms I want you to explain, please. You say this, quote, "The logic of these two results, low heritability and high polygenicity," which I want you to define, "clearly demonstrate that the dominant cultural narrative about sexual orientation, which sees homosexual persons as a distinctly bounded biological class of people who were born that way, simply cannot be true." That's the end of the quote. So can you summarize in a way that's portable for lay people why born that way at an empirical level cannot be true?
Sure, I'll try my best.
Okay.
Low heritability, we've talked about it. It means that there's a very small genetic influence on sexual orientation. It's not non-existent. But it's not large, and it's not determinative. It's lower than lots of things that we understand not to be innately determined or compelled.
Okay.
The other issue, high polygenicity, means that there is no single spot on the human genome that is responsible for someone's sexual orientation. Now, that idea is popularly known as the gay gene.
Right.
And this study that I'm writing about here explicitly rejected the idea of a gay gene because the genetic influences on sexual orientation are very small influences spread across hundreds of places on the human genome.
Okay.
Basically, it means that someone who has same-sex attraction has a perfectly normal genotype.
Right.
Their genotype cannot be distinguished from anyone else. The lead author of the study, trying to explain this to the New York Times, said it will be basically impossible to predict one's sexual activity or orientation just from genetics.
Okay.
The New York Times titled its article summarizing this study as follows: "Many genes influence same-sex sexuality, not a single gay gene." So that's what polygenicity tells us.
Okay.
It means that it basically closes off the frenetic study, frenetic search that has gone on to try to find something called a gay gene. It says not only did we not find a gay gene, we found that no one's ever going to find a gay gene.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful that you said it that way. Friends, our topic today is this: are people born gay? Our expert guest is Father Paul Sullins, the Catholic University in America and the Ruth Institute. So, Father, taking this as a starting point, that same-sex attraction is not genetically determined, that would mean that acting on same-sex attraction is not inevitable. It's not overwhelming. The way that I find myself being left-handed is overwhelming.
Right.
So where do we go now in terms of, is same-sex attraction a choice?
Right. Well, there's very low genetic influence. There are lots of things that we can think of that have higher genetic heritability than same-sex attraction that we agree are not compelled, that they're in the range of choice. One example that I like is our religious affiliation.
Mm-hmm.
The heritability of religious affiliation is about 0.36, a little higher than same-sex attraction, which is about 0.32. And yet, I don't know of anybody in the world who thinks that there's a gene that determines our religious affiliation. People often say they were born Baptist or I'm a cradle Catholic, but they don't mean that they're genetically compelled to be Catholic. We believe people have a choice. Right? In fact, we defend that as a human right.
Sure, of course.
People can make that choice. Nonetheless, we recognize that there is a strong genetic influence on those things. Now, the same can be said for same-sex attraction. Now, we have to distinguish when we talk about people who are gay. Mm-hmm. We generally mean three things by that. Either one mm-hmm. of three things or sometimes all three things together. We mean if someone says I'm gay, they're describing who they're attracted to sexually. So mm-hmm. they have same-sex attraction versus opposite mm-hmm. sex attraction. Mm-hmm. Who they would like or prefer to have sex relations with. That's the first thing. We call that attraction. The second would be identity, what they call themselves. Mm-hmm. If they call themselves gay or if they call themselves heterosexual or something in between, that's another marker. Now, the third is who they actually have sex relations with, mm-hmm. whether they have sex with persons of the same sex or sex with persons of the opposite sex. And so that would be behavior. So we have these three components of same-sex being or personage, and all three of those components do not overlap in the population.
Okay.
There are only, in fact, a small minority of persons who are congruent on all three of those, who are attracted to persons of the same sex, who call themselves gay, and who only have sex with persons of the same sex. That's only about 20% of the people who claim any one of these identities. So there are, for example, a lot of persons who say, my attraction is to persons of the same sex, but I am married or I'm in a relationship with someone of the opposite sex.
Okay.
And they have chosen, often for religious reasons, to enter into a marriage, even though if you ask, well, who are you actually attracted to? It's persons of the same sex. There are a lot of persons who have sex with persons of the same sex who say they're not attracted to persons of the same sex. It would be the opposite case. And the best example of this would be homosexual prostitutes.
Mm-hmm.
Many of those young men, they say, I'm not gay, but, you know, I sell myself out to gay men because I can get money for it. These things are not congruent. So it's entirely possible for someone to be attracted at some fundamental level to persons of the same sex, but to choose not to adopt a gay identity or to have formally adopted a gay identity and to change that and to adopt a homosexual identity, to either live in chastity, abstaining from sex relations altogether, or even to enter into sex relations with persons of the opposite sex.
What I find intriguing about what you're reporting is that it seems a lot more complex and nuanced than the popular narrative that you see in headlines. I mean, if you were visiting from another planet and you just scan the headlines, even just in the United States, you would think a very large minority, born a majority of people, are same-sex attracted, act on it, and are very happy with it. And the only people who aren't happy are the people who've been scolded by haters who presumably get large paychecks either from the Vatican or the Westboro Baptist Church. And, you know, we're told if we only admit that people who have same-sex attraction are born that way, that their actions are absolutely inevitable of moral equivalence to heterosexual action, then we could all live happily ever after. Am I understanding you correctly that the data doesn't line up with that narrative?
No, there is a huge disconnect between what's known in the scientific scholarly literature and what's reported in the media. I would not pay much attention to what's in the media. You may mm-hmm. have heard someone call it fake news. Well, this mm-hmm. is really fake science in a lot of ways, what you mm-hmm. hear reported. A collection of the best of sexual scholars on this area of sexual orientation, none of whom are conservative religious type people, mm-hmm. have written that, quote, one can certainly make choices mm-hmm. about whether one adopts a homosexual identity or engages in relations with persons of the same sex despite having same-sex orientation. That's not some partisan group that's saying this. This is the APA's own research. If you look at the APA's, by the way, APA is the American Psychological Association.
Right.
And the American Psychological Association's Handbook of Sexuality and Psychology acknowledges this amazing fact. Same-sex orientation and opposite-sex orientation are not mutually exclusive. More of one doesn't necessarily mean less of the other. Now, this study that I'm citing here, by the way, the author of the study is named Ghana, G-A-N-N-A, or you maybe you could pronounce it Ghana. And if the listeners Google Ghana and GWAS, G-W-A-S, or sexual orientation, they'll be able to find this study. It's publicly available. Ghana, in this study, also confirmed that the scale, the thinking that sexual orientation is on a scale from heterosexual to homosexual is false. They call for doing away with that. It's called the Kinsey scale, right? They say we should no longer use that. We should use separate scales to measure someone's same-sex attraction and someone's opposite-sex attraction because they don't correspond to one another. A person can be very high on both or very low on both. And so this whole idea that somehow I'm locked into some particular behavior, depending on how I may or may not relate to persons of the same sex, is false. If you look at population data, we've known this from forever. If you look, for instance, at the General Social Survey, which is a statistical snapshot of the United States population, it asks people, who were your sexual partners in the past year? Were they men or women? And then in the past 5 years, and then in your lifetime. And if you look at those who report that my sexual partners in the past 5 years were only men, you look back and you find that most of those report having sexual partners that were only women earlier in their life. And if you look at the ones who say, if you look at the ones who have ever reported having only same-sex partners and some significant period of their life, only a very small proportion of them have only same-sex partners now. Not only can homosexual behavior change, it is one of the most transient forms of human relationships that we know.
Father, I'm sure you're aware, at least as well as I am, that in some states, if a therapist suggests to a client, you don't have to act on your same-sex attraction, that therapist might lose his license. What's going on there?
Right. Well, there's a concerted attempt to drown out opposing voices. And in that case, there are people who are working very hard not to allow someone even to consider the possibility of changing their sexual orientation. They raise the specter of what's called conversion therapy, often with some scare stories or two, to say that this is a way of coercing someone not to be able to follow who they, quote, truly are. And so it's related to the issue of the genetic determinism of same-sex attraction. If, in fact, same-sex attraction is not determined, is not innate, then there's no basis in evidence, anyway, for trying to convince people not to be homosexual or not to act on their homosexual impulses when they feel them. It is a kind of intolerance. It says that in order to fully accept homosexual behavior, we have to outlaw heterosexual behavior among people who may have homosexual attractions. It's kind of the dark side of gay marriage. I mean, people who are same-sex attracted have won the right in civil law to engage in same-sex marriage, and now they're in a way saying that if you're same-sex attracted, you can't engage in opposite-sex marriage. So it's kind of turned south, turned negative on that. I think that the tide is changing, okay. and that we're moving toward a better outcome on this. But I'm not sure about that. There are signs that that's happening. The evidence that a person is harmed by trying to change their sexual orientation is mm-hmm. non-existent. There are a number of studies that people will try to point to in making that case, but there's not a single study that has a credible sample that uses reliable measures that has found anything close to the kind of harm that's claimed for this. So that recently the forces of light have begun to win some of the court cases pushing back against the prohibition of someone considering changing their sexual orientation. I should say that the conversion therapy, as it's described by these alarmists, is mm-hmm. something that never happens today, at mm-hmm. least to my knowledge. It's certainly in no legitimate therapeutic situation is it going to happen. But what usually happens is that someone will go in for therapy with a number of traumas or life conditions. And as part of the complex of issues that affect their struggles now or their pain now, sexual orientation, a non-heterosexual sexual orientation might be among those. And so they begin mm-hmm. to look at that issue. And often when they look at that issue or when they address some of the other traumas that they've experienced, the same-sex attraction or the impulse toward it diminishes or goes away. A prime example would be child sexual abuse.
Yes.
This is a hot topic for Catholics, right? But
sure.
boys who have been abused by older men often mistakenly think that they have become homosexual.
Right.
And it's only maybe years later as they're exploring and developing their own sexual identity or trying to enter into a relationship with a woman that they deal with this. And it comes out in therapy. Belief that they have that they are homosexual begins to be challenged and will often begin to change or resolve as a result of that.
Friends, our mature topic today is are people born gay or ex-precesses? Father Paul Sullins, research professor of sociology of the Catholic University of America and senior research associate of the Ruth Institute. I know the Ruth Institute recently sponsored an event in Rochester, New York with Hudson Piblow, who told the story that is very familiar to me as a priest, maybe to you, Father, as both a priest and a researcher, and Dr. Morris of the Ruth Institute had heard the story very often. A boy grows up kind of confused, gets sexually abused by an adult, decides as a result of the abuse that he's same-sex attracted, and then is encouraged by the culture to act on those impulses. How common is that dynamic? Do we have data on that?
I would have no idea. I don't know that we have good
okay.
data on that. But
okay.
it's kind of a typical scenario that you hear.
Sure,
from
sure.
people who have done this kind of therapy a lot.
So the
American Psychological Association had a task force that reviewed these kinds of therapeutic interventions.
Mm-hmm.
These, by the way, are called Sexual Orientation Change Efforts, or SOCE,
mm-hmm.
to
mm-hmm.
distinguish them from the Specter of Conversion Therapy. And I think maybe they've even moved on to a different term, but that's the term that the APA was addressing. And they
mm-hmm.
concluded in that task force that there was no evidence to date that could provide a clear picture of whether SOCE was either beneficial or harmful.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you ask someone who doesn't have any particular opinion on this in the scientific world, does trying to change someone's sexual orientation cause harm, the best answer that they can give is, we don't know. The evidence,
okay.
there's no evidence that would show that. And this was recently confirmed just last month by a Florida court who struck down a citywide ban in Tampa on talk conversion therapy or SOCE
mm-hmm.
efforts. And the mm-hmm. court said this, quote, no known study has provided a comprehensive assessment of the basic demographic information, psychosocial well-being, and religiosity, which would be required to withstand, understand the effectiveness, benefits, and or harm caused by SOCE. Mm-hmm. The court ruling extensively cited the experts who were brought in by the city to argue for a ban, and all mm-hmm. of the experts that they brought in had to admit that while they had their opinions and they had their biases, they didn't have any evidence to support what they were saying. And so the court ruled against the ban. Actually, the court ruled that the city didn't have standing to impose a ban, that that would have to be imposed by a state legislature, that it was not cities who had jurisdiction over the professional therapy. And the state legislature in Florida is nowhere near trying to implement such a ban because there is no evidence for it. There's a lot of political correctness, but there's no evidence at all for this.
Father, I'm trying to sort this out in my mind. So walk with me as I try to unfold this in my own mind.
Sure.
Suppose we've got two different scenarios. You know, person A walks into a therapist and says, I think I'm same-sex attracted and I want you to fix me. And then another person walks into a therapist. Person B says, I think I may be same-sex attracted. I want to know what my options are. Must I act on it? What's the likely outcome of either conversation, on your view?
Well, I'm not a therapist, so I can only make a guess here. But one of the primary commitments of therapy is for the therapist not to impose their own perspective on the one that's receiving the therapy. Mm-hmm. Everyone has a right to choose the goal of their therapy and sort of the moral or religious context in which they want to pursue that therapy. So I think that a good therapist would try to explore those issues with that person. Now, if the person in the first case said, I want you to fix me, you'd have to explore why they're saying that.
Right.
Because are they experiencing deep interpersonal pain because of this, or are they hearing from someone else who just doesn't like who they are? Are their parents telling them this? And this is what would be important to me, are they interacting with their religious faith? Mm-hmm. Are they hearing that this is not something that's consistent with a walk with Christ? And they want to live a life as a faithful Christian. And in that case, I think then that would be an issue to explore.
Right.
What it means for someone to live having same-sex attraction and to be a faithful Christian. Can you do that while having same-sex attraction? Well, I think the answer to that is emphatically yes. I think that people who experience attraction to persons of the same sex have a provision in the possibilities of the Christian life to live very clearly in the will of God and in a state of grace.
Certainly. Jesus, you know, I do work with Courage International, which is, you know, founded by the late Father John Harvey, and, you know, it reaches out to people who are experiencing same-sex attraction, very often very persistent same-sex attraction. And they recognize the universal call to chastity and to holiness. And they make avail themselves of all the natural and supernatural helps to be chaste, to be holy, even while experiencing persistent same-sex attraction. And my concern for some of the conversation that's taking place in religious circles is that those people who I think are heroic and virtuous are actually suckers. That somehow, that, you know, all the virtue they acquired, all the sacrifices, all the efforts they made, they really weren't necessary at all. They could have blissfully acted on all those impulses and been in a state of grace all along. And from a theological and pastoral point of view, I find that really painful when I think of the heroic people I've met for Courage International. So, Father, based on I'm not a therapist, you're not a therapist, but based on the evidence, is it fair to say that if one experiences same-sex attraction, one can legitimately seek help to not act on that that impulse?
Absolutely.
Okay.
One can legitimately do that on the basis of the best evidence that we have put forth by the most avid pro-LGBT sexual scholars, who said in a 2015 study, which I cite in that public discourse article that you mentioned, this APA team said of people who have neurological same-sex attraction, they say that's unlikely to change, and I agree with that.
Okay.
But suppose you have neurological same-sex attraction. They say this, quote, "It is, of course, possible to change one's sexual orientation identity, and one can certainly make choices about whether one will or will not engage in same-sex or opposite-sex sexual behavior or become celibate." So that's the highest authority that we know that's telling us from a scientific framework that people do not have to be compelled to act upon same-sex attraction.
Well, Father, we're certainly going to have you on again to talk about why science is saying one thing and the media and the culture is saying something else. So far, Father, I think we can agree that what the popular culture and the media are telling us is that, number one, people are born gay. Number two, if you're born gay, you must act on it. And number three, the only way you can be happy if you're born gay is to act on your same-sex attraction. And I think in our conversation, the evidence contradicts all of those. So the question becomes, who do we trust? I mean, do we just look for the cover of Time magazine? Do we look for someone with the largest social media following? How do we become wise consumers of information regarding this very important topic?
Sure. Well, you are asking me, a Catholic priest to another Catholic priest, who do we trust for truth? The answer has to be that we trust the Holy Spirit working through the legitimate structures of the Catholic Church.
Mm-hmm.
I will trust the Pope to lead us into truth. Now, people cringe when I say that nowadays because a lot of good Catholics don't trust the Pope. I think that's a mistake. I think that we have to trust the Pope. And in a way, because as the first Pope said to our Lord himself, who else has the words to eternal life? Where are we going to go? I think that was him. Maybe it was someone else.
Well, no, I mean, it was certainly St. Peter who said, you know, Lord, to whom shall we go? And it's certainly true that and we've based our lives on this, Father, you and me, that the fullness of truth is not an idea or concept, but it's a person, and the person of Christ, the eternal Word of the Father, his legacy and living spirit has been entrusted to the one church he founded. So to be in harmony with perennial Rome, so to speak, is foundational. And part of what the church has always taught is that we can use our senses and our reason to do good science. And this is why I find our conversation today so stimulating, is that you're very, very careful with your use of evidence, your use of the data. You wouldn't even let me rhetorically nudge you beyond the evidence, and I salute you for that. But for folks who are you know, looking at the media, looking at headlines, and who say, well, okay, you guys have your Catholic thing. I think it's great that you guys are confident in your Catholic thing. I'm not confident in the Catholic thing. So where can people turn for reliable information on same-sex attraction and the choices that follow from it?
Right. Well, you know, there's two things that Pope Francis has said about these issues that I think are golden, that every Catholic should know and hold of great value. The first is that whenever Francis has addressed it, the issue of the gender ideology, that is the idea that people can become some other gender or people can have same-sex attraction versus normal opposite-sex attraction, he has reacted strongly. And he has said, this is a lie of the devil. It's a work of the devil. He has gone out of his way to drive this point home. Now, Francis, when he talks about the devil, he's not talking about some abstract idea. He's talking about a real devil. And I would encourage everyone to read his latest book on spiritual warfare and rebuking the devil. So Francis sees this falsehood that we're talking about, this deception in our media, as demonic, as something that comes from the devil. That's a very radical point of view, but it comes right from the very heart of our church, and I think we should pay attention to it. The other thing that Francis has said very clearly is that two men or two women getting in together into some sort of relationship is nowhere near what God has intended for in marriage, that there is nowhere near the equivalence or affinity between those two things. That actual Christian marriage, which is the only context that God has made for human sexuality, is nothing near what two persons of the same sex can achieve. That's also a very, very strong statement. It takes a lot of courage for someone to make that kind of statement in our media environment, and someone who, like Francis, considers himself to be progressive or to be in line with progressive ideals, and yet on this issue, remarkably, he is as emphatic about the confirming what we read in the Bible and what we understand from our faith traditionally and historically as any pope. In fact, I would say in some ways he's more emphatic than his predecessor, Pope Benedict, or even Pope John Paul II. If not in his belief, he's much more emphatic in the way he expresses things, because he's not a theologian or a philosopher like those guys were. So I think that we can look to the center of our faith and hold this up. There's lots of things that Francis has done that lead people to question or have some confusion about him. But on this premier issue of our day, he is rock solid as far as I'm concerned. He has no patience for anyone advocating same-sex marriage. He's very clear that is something that we need to oppose and to stand against, that it is inconsistent with the Word of God and the life of faith as strongly as anyone ever has been.
Friends, we're talking with Father Paul Sillins of the Catholic University of America. We're asking the question, are people born gay? I think the science, we can agree, says no. We're talking now about how to be a wise consumer of information regarding same-sex attraction. Father, I think we can both agree that there's no substitute for doing your own homework. And I think one of the temptations of going to headlines or going to experts is that way I don't have to work and I don't have to think. So for all the things we said, I said, find out for yourself whether or not Father Sillins is right. The research is all there. Everyone has in their hands a little electronic magic story box where you can look at the evidence and draw your own conclusions. Father, for people who are just walking around and they have a sense that they've been lied to by the media, what advice can you give them for people who are thoughtful and take science seriously?
Well, if you look at my public discourse article, first of all, I have footnotes there that lead to studies that you can pull up and you can read, and you can check out the truth of what I say there. I also have I'm a little reticent to mention this, but because I'm not sure how it would work logistically. But I also have a resource document that gives much more detail on these things, and comes with a Google Drive folder that contains all of the copies of all of the articles that I would reference that people can read and look at this for themselves, that are legal to put in such state. And that's almost all of them by this time. So if we can work out a way, I don't want to say send me an email because I'm not sure I could respond to the emails, but I can make a link to that research available. Maybe
if you can get that to us, then we could promote it for you. Okay, very good. Father Paul Sillins
can look for themselves.
Father Paul Sillins of the Catholic University of America and the Ruth Institute, thank you for being a splendid guest. Let's continue the conversation again soon.
Thank you, Father McTeague. God bless you.
Just been listening to Father Paul Sillins talking with Father Robert McTeague on the Station of the Crosses, The Catholic Current. They're discussing whether God makes people gay, which seems to be suggested by the current crop of Born This Way sloganeering. Check out the show notes for Father Paul Sillins' associated article, Born That Way No More, The New Science of Sexual Orientation, as well as the Ghana study referenced in their discussion, and a link to Hudson Biblo's November talk, Something More Beautiful. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.